Today's date is August 30th, 1995. This is an interview with Viola Kohn. The maiden name is Viola Iboya or Ibi Rivka Bleier, B-L-E-I-E-R. I'm the interviewer, Roseanne Krusner, K-R-U-S-N-E-R. We're in Toronto, Canada, and the language of the interview is in English. Today's date is August 30th, 1995. This is an interview with Viola Kohn, maiden name Viola Iboya or Ibi Rivka Bleier. The interviewer is me, Roseanne Krusner, K-R-U-S-N-E-R. We're in Toronto, Canada, and the language of the interview is in English. Please introduce yourself.
My name is Viola Kohn.
What is your maiden name?
Bleier, Iboya Bleier.
Do you have a middle name?
No.
Do you have a Hebrew name?
Yes, Rivka.
Where were you born?
I was born in Czechoslovakia, and it's on border of Hungary.
What's the name of the city or town?
Czechov.
What large city is that near?
It's Šatorovy Hal. It's near Šatorovy Hal. It's about 20 kilometers from our town.
When were you born?
I was born in August 17, 1927.
So at the time of this interview, how old are you?
I'm 68.
Can you tell me about the Jewish community where you lived?
Well, it was a small town, so we had about 12 families living there.
12 Jewish families?
12 Jewish families. And about probably around 3,000 non-Jews.
Were they integrated, the Jews and the non-Jews?
Yeah, we got along very good, yes.
Did you have Jewish as well as non-Jewish friends?
Yes, mostly non-Jewish because there wasn't too many Jewish my age kids.
Did you meet these friends in school?
Yes.
What kind of school did you go to?
It was a Catholic school, Roman Catholic.
What was it like being a Jew in a Roman Catholic school?
At that time, there was no prejudice or anything. I didn't find anything that it was that they were pointing fingers or anything.
Did you study?
Just got along fine with them.
Did you study religion?
No religion. When there was religion, we were dismissed. There was about 6 or 7 Jewish kids there. That's all.
And did you have Jewish studies in addition to that?
No, my brothers and my the one who had Jewish, they went to Jewish schools, but they had to go to a different town. But girls we didn't have.
How many brothers and sisters did you have?
I had 4 brothers and 4 sisters with me. We were 8 altogether kids.
Can you tell me their names?
Yes, my oldest brother was Yenu. That's in English probably Jack. The second oldest brother was Mike Miklos. The third was Robert. And the little one was Shmelko, Teddy. My oldest sister was Charlotte. Second oldest, Olga. The third, Relly, and myself.
And can you tell me your parents' names?
Yes, my father's name is David. In Jewish, they called him Dubid. And my mother's name was Regina. In Jewish, Rachel, Ruchel.
How did your father support the family?
He was he was making blueprints for houses and in construction. Yes.
Did he build your house?
He built our house. He built where we lived was a all new street called Nova Street, which is it's in English it's new, and he built the whole street. When I remember, when I was about 11, when he was still building and he was still in that business before the Hungarians came in.
Can you tell me what your house looked like if I went in?
Yes. We had a... Going up to the house was three steps. When you come in, we had a big veranda, which was all glass, and we had a holiday sukkahs that the top opened, so we celebrated it there. Then we had four bedrooms and a kitchen. There was no living room or dining room. It was a big kitchen and four bedrooms. And then we had a summer kitchen that was under the house. And we had a big backyard with lots of fruit trees that my father planted. And we had servants. We had a guy who looked after the horses and cows, and a lady who looked after the house. That was in Czechoslovakia's time.
Did you attend synagogue?
Yes. My parents were religious, yes.
What was the synagogue like?
Well, we had the synagogue in our house for a long time because they were building a new synagogue. There was no synagogue, so we had an extra room in front of our house, and that's where all the Jewish people came to pray. I don't even remember if the new synagogue was built before we left, but I know that they used to pray there Friday night and Saturday, and every morning and every night.
Did you have a rabbi to lead the
yes,
service?
Yes, we had a rabbi.
Was he from the town as well?
Yes, he was from town.
Can you tell me what a typical Shabbat dinner would have been like in your home?
Yes, we didn't have gefilte fish, but we had false fish, because fish was rare there. In that part of Europe, there was no oceans in Eastern Europe where we lived. So my mom used to make from chicken breast false fish, which is I sometimes make it now too. And it made the same way. Then we had chicken soup. We had roast duck or geese. Or my mother, they used to bake the challah, twisted challah, Fridays. And we had desserts and nice supper.
Can you tell me what your relationship was like with your father and then also your mother?
Very close. I was very close to my mom. I was 17 by the time I was separated from her, but I felt like I was 11, 10, I don't know. I was very close with her. I never left her side. I was always with her. I was the only one who was home at the time of when the Germans came, and my brother, my little brother. The rest of my sisters and brothers, they left home already by then. So I was very close to her, and I just couldn't imagine living without her.
And your father, what kind of man was he like?
He was a very quiet, good man. He wasn't affectionate as my mom, but he used to always kiss us on the head. And I had a little thing here, and he always goes, because he had the same thing, and he went like this. He says, "That's from me. You have this from me." And you know, he was affectionate as much as my mom. He was like more like a man, and they were not. Today the fathers are different, I think, a little bit. They're more, but that time they showed that they were the strong in the family, and he told me to be home at 7, I had to be home at 7. So it was a different kind of life then.
Did your father read a lot?
Yes, he was a scholar, yeah, he read a lot, in Hebrew.
What kind, was it all religious? Or?
Religious things, and newspapers.
What kind of newspapers did you receive in your
family?
They
had, I don't remember, but I know it was under the Czechoslovakian, there was Slovak paper. And after the Hungarian came, so they had Hungarian paper, so my mother used to read it for him because he couldn't read Hungarian. So she used to read loud to him.
What languages did you speak at home?
I spoke Czechoslovakian till about 11. Then we started to go to, when the Hungarian came over in 38, so we started going, they started teaching us Hungarian, but the Hungarian language was very familiar to me because my mom, she used to speak Hungarian to me, and I used to answer her in Czech. And when we started Hungarian school, so the teachers always gave us as an example that how good we read in Hungarian and how good we are, because the rest of the kids, they spoke only Czechoslovakian, but language was familiar, so I learned faster. We learned faster in Hungarian, yeah.
So your mother was from Hungary?
Yes.
And your father?
Czech. He was born there. His grandfather was born there. That's why one day after the Hungarians came over, took over, they took all the Jews all away from the town, because they were born in Poland or some other cities and they were not Czechoslovakian citizens. So the only Jews who was left in our town was us and my father's brother, they used to live there too. So they took them away, and by the evening they came back. So I don't know what happened, why they took them, then they brought them back.
What was your father's brother's name?
Julius.
Can you tell me about that time when your town became from Czechoslovakia to Hungary?
Hungary. Well, when the Hungarian came, they were called the soldiers Magyar Szabad Csapat, which means they were like free to do anything they wanted with the Jews. So the first thing they did, they robbed all the Jewish businesses, because most of the people who lived in the town, they had a store, or they had a butcher store, or a shoe repair, or all kinds of those. So they robbed all that. They broke the windows. They took all the Jewish, older Jewish people, and their sons, who had sons, and the son had to step on their father's shoulders and pull their beards and hit their fathers. It was a terrible night. When they came in, it was like, we didn't know what to do. We were lucky because my father was well known there. And there was not a Catholic, but a Protestant. A Russian Protestant pastor who hit my father, because they came for him too. But he hit them. He had like a villa there, and he hit him. And my brothers, one wasn't home, and the other one, they came in the middle of the night, and they took him because he was wearing, the same day, he was wearing a wine-colored shirt, and they said he's a communist, because apparently red meant communist. So they took him and they beat him. And the next day, my two brothers left town because they said they cannot stay in this place where they are treated the way they are.
Which two brothers?
The oldest, Jano and Miklos. They left and they went to Prague, Czechoslovakia, because we were Czechs before, but when the Hungarians took us over, so they said they're going to try to go over the border and they're going to try to stay there.
Was this the first time your family had experienced that kind of anti-Jewish actions?
The first time. Before, there was no problems before, but the minute the Hungarians came over, our neighbor changed like day and night. See, when we had the trees, like it was like a fence. So they said that the trees belongs to them because they go more to their side. So we said, so my father said, okay, you can have the half a fruit which goes on your, no, they wanted the whole thing.
Now these are the fruit trees that your father planted?
Yeah, yeah. And they turned like devils against Jews. He says, Jews, you're gonna die now. You're bad. You're good for nothing. You're stealing from us. It changed. The whole thing changed. Okay, it's like not everybody, but most of them changed.
Now you had non-Jewish friends in school.
Yeah, I had non-Jewish friends, and her father was in the same business as my father. So when the Hungarians came, my father couldn't work anymore. So all the work went to her father, you know, and it was like a rivalry, you know, between us and them. So, like, I lost even her friend because we were kids, so we didn't mix in too much. But the two fathers, I guess, because after that my father couldn't work, and
was it just in his profession he couldn't work or at all?
Nothing. They couldn't work. We had to wear. No, we didn't wear yellow stripes. No, we just couldn't. They just took all the Jewish people who could work and put them in working commandos. So my father wasn't that young, but they took him and he in the town and he had to dig ditches. My brother, the one who was there, who was Robbie, who was there, he was born in 22, so at that time he must have been in 38. 16, they took him out of town, and we never seen him after. So the things changed terrible after the Hungarians came over, because there was nobody said don't do this or don't do that. Whatever they wanted to do or take or hit somebody, they were allowed to do it.
How did things change for you in school?
In school, well, we were like leopards in school. You know, they were pointing fingers, you're a Jew, you're a dirty Jew. And after about a year, we couldn't even go to school anymore. Jewish kids couldn't go to school. So we were home, we didn't go to school, we didn't play with the other kids. We were isolated from them because the other kids wouldn't play with us because they heard their parents talking that you're a dirty Jew and you steal from us and you do this and you do that. So there, it was bad.
Your two oldest brothers left town. Did your parents consider that at all?
Yes, they were. They said, "You go if you think you can find a better life," because they were afraid for us too. So they went, and they stayed in Prague from 1938 till 1944. One of my brother, the oldest brother, got engaged to a girl there. Her father was a rabbi. And they wrote home and they sent us money because they could work, we couldn't work. I mean, my father couldn't work already, so they sent us money. And just before, in 39 or 40, the Germans went into Czechoslovakia. I'm not sure what year it was, but they started to deport the Czechoslovakian Jews. So my two brothers wanted to come back to Hungary because the Hungarian Jews didn't deport them yet, but they were caught on the border. And two Czechoslovakian Hungarian gendarmes came over to our place and showed my mother pictures. She says, "Is that your son?" And she says, "Yes." And she says to them, "Where did you get the picture?" He says, "Just answer me if he's your son or not." And she says, "Yes, I told you." He says, "Just tell me one thing, if they're alive." And he slapped her. And she fainted. She fainted, and they would never say that if they were alive or dead. And then about 6 months later, we got a postcard from Birkenau. The only thing they said that they were well and we're working, because that's all they were allowed to say it.
They were able to send a letter?
A postcard saying that we're working and we're well. So then, you know, my mother felt a little bit better, because she was always saying, "The only thing I want is to see my kids all together once more." So then they took them to, we knew that they took them to Poland, but that's all we heard from them.
And you never heard from your third brother?
We never heard from our third brother because they took him into working camp, and nothing. Just before, when the Germans came in 1944, and the whole thing started again with the Jews, and we had to wear yellow stars. The Jews were not allowed to go out at night. The Jews were not allowed to do anything. And we heard stories that they taking Polish Jews and Czechoslovakian Jews to camps, labor camps that they work. And then some people, you know, they ran away from Poland or from Czechoslovakia, so they came to Hungary, and they were telling all kind of stories. But we said, no, it's impossible. In 20th century, things like that don't happen.
Did these refugees come to your house as well?
They came to our house. We took them in for 2 nights, and then they went to bigger cities. Because in our place, they would find them right away. It's a small thing, so they knew that they can stay there. So they said they're going to Budapest. But you couldn't travel then. You had to travel as a non-Jew. Like for girls was easy, but for guys was harder. And if you looked like you didn't look like a Jewish person, then it was okay. That's how one of my sisters came home. She was in a school in Nyíregyháza, it's called, in Hungary. And we sent a girl, a non-Jewish girl, who used to work for us, to bring her home with a carriage and a horse. That's how she came home, like a non-Jew, because the Jewish people couldn't travel. So then one night they came and everybody had to go. They told us to take everybody a suitcase, pack whatever we can, and they took us to a empty gymnasium room or something, and we stayed there overnight.
Now that's when the Germans came in.
That's when the Germans about? In 1944.
Just to go back a little bit, during that period when it was Hungary that you were living
mm-hmm.
in, and your father wasn't able to work anymore,
mm-hmm.
your brothers sent you money
mm-hmm.
from Czechoslovakia.
Mm-hmm.
But how were you able to live? Did your lifestyle change dramatically?
Well, it did change, but you see, we had fields. So we grew potatoes, we grew vegetables, we had chickens, we had cows. So we had what to eat. And we had, before, stored wheat. And they had a place where they made flour. So we had, you know, flour, and we hid them. We had underground, hid all those things, because otherwise they would have taken it away. So we had what to eat. Not as good as before, but we didn't go hungry. And there were some people who brought us potatoes. Or my one of our neighbors said, if you want to come and help me dig potatoes, like I was about 12, 13, so she gave me a bushel of potatoes. So we had those things, you know, vegetables and those things, yeah. And because you couldn't travel, you couldn't buy, and when the stores were closed, there wasn't much to buy. Everybody who lived there in that, it was like a farm, so everybody made their own food. Like, we didn't go to a store and bought food to eat.
Did
you
grew
it.
Did you have radios or any kind of communication?
No.
Just newspapers to hear
yeah.
what was going on outside?
Just newspapers, yeah.
So when the Germans actually did come in, how did life change after that?
Life changed terrible then. We didn't stay in the town anymore, because a week after that, they took us in a, like I said, in a big, everybody, all the 12, whoever was there, 12 families. And the next day, we had to evacuate and walk to the, How did we go? I think they no. They took us with horses and carriages, because there was only 12 families. So they took us to Hungary, to Czechoslovakia, and they put us in a ghetto. And apparently we had some family there who lived there, and the ghetto was in that place. So we stayed with them for a while, with my father's brother's daughter.
When you left your home in your hometown, what were you able to bring with you?
Not much. We brought some things, clothes, linen. They told us whatever we can to put in a suitcase. So everybody had a suitcase, not much.
How much time were you given to pack?
About 2 hours. And everything, we left everything. We only took clothes and some linen and covering for beds, like, you know, so if we go someplace we should have where to sleep.
Did you see your neighbors or anyone else in the town when you left?
No, because it was nighttime. When they took us into the rooms, into the hall, it was a nighttime and it was closed. And the next night they took us. So it took us about almost half a night to get to, because it was about 20 kilometers. When we got to Uihel, it was like a funeral procession, you know. Everything was drawn down, the shades, there was nobody on the street. We walked, we had started to walk like five in a row already. And we were taking those things, so I can hardly walk. So, and it was Hungarian and German soldiers with guns, and I was a little bit slow, so one German hit me, and my mother stood up and she says, "Don't you ever touch my child." And what did he do? So he hit her, you know. I was crying, she was crying, everybody was crying, because they were so mean. They were hitting old people. They were they had those rubber things, and if you didn't go the way they wanted you to go, they were hitting and hitting and hitting. And some people, you know, old people, mostly old people were there, because there was not many young people, because the young people they took away. So they were all old people left. So it was a terrible thing. By the time we got to the ghetto, we were, you know, we didn't know what was going on, what was happening. I was somehow too young to absorb everything, you know, like I was with my parents, so that's all I needed, you know. But I just said, what are they going to do with us? We asked my parents, so don't worry, nothing's going to happen, you're going to be with us. And everything is going to be okay. And we stayed there in the ghetto a few weeks, and they were making the ghetto always smaller and smaller and smaller. And they had we couldn't get out of the ghetto. We were in there, so they were the last time, just before they took us away. We were in a place where there were little rooms. I think there was, you know, in Europe they had houses for bad girls. Oh.
We're going to stop here and go to the next tape.
Okay.
You were telling us about the ghetto and where they took you.
Mm-hmm. They took us to a red district.
A red light district?
A red light district. The last week that we were in the ghetto. And we were sleeping, it was a very small room, like we had two mattresses. It was only my father, myself, my mother, myself, and my sister and my brother, five of us.
Which sister?
Rally. And we were there for about a week. And I can't remember how we ate, because there was no stove, there was no... I remember they, I think what happened was that they, the ghetto had a kitchen, like for everybody, and they brought food to everybody. I guess that's all I can think of, because I can't remember back. But I know that they, one day they came, and because they were talking, everybody was talking, they're going to take us to Poland, they're going to take us to Poland, and I didn't even know what they were talking about. But my father says, once we go on the train, he'll find out the minute we're on the train if they're going east. If we're going east, that means we're going to Poland, and that's the worst place that they can take us, because he heard a lot of things about it. So we marched to the wagons, about 100 people in one wagon that we couldn't even sit down. We were standing up for 3 days.
Just before you go onto the transports,
yeah,
can we talk a little bit more about the ghetto?
Yeah, okay.
Were there restrictions as to when you could go out and when you could not?
In the ghetto? In the ghetto, no, because you couldn't go out of the ghetto. There was a little, very small area that was fenced in. So they had German and Hungarian soldiers before, outside the ghetto, so you couldn't get out. But there was no place to go, really.
Did you have to wear a yellow star?
We had to, yes, everybody had to wear a yellow star, yeah.
Do you remember that first time you were given the yellow star to wear?
Yes, I remember. Somehow it didn't shock me or anything. I was just wearing it, and I guess I was wearing it with pride. You know, that it was a Jewish Magen David, like, you know, and I had to wear it, and I didn't care what other people thought. So, no, I didn't. I knew it's going to come, because, you know, you hear things. But it didn't bother me.
Before they took you to the transports, how long were you in the ghetto, approximately?
Could be about 2 months we were in the ghetto.
And approximately when was it that they transported you?
In May. Oh, to go to Germany? To the camps? I think in May, end of May.
So can you tell me now, to go back again, to what the transports were like?
Okay. We walked to the train station, and there were German and Hungarian soldiers pushing us into the wagons. About 100 people in one wagon. They put two pails, empty pails, and that's it, and closed the wagon. There was a little window on the top with a little wire window that, if somebody was tall, you could see out. For the 3 days that we went, at least 5 people died in the train. The heat and you had to go to those two pails. People went to the washrooms. There was no food, so we just stayed like against each other. Once they opened the for 3 days, I think we went, and once they opened the door, just to empty the buckets. So by the time we got to wherever I didn't know where we was, but when they opened the doors, they started to scream, "Arouse, arouse!" That means get out, get out. Everybody went down, and they said, "The man, you stay here, and the woman, you stay here." And
just to go back a little bit, when you were in the train, mm-hmm. was there conversations between family members?
Yes. Well, yeah, we talked, and they all said that we're going to Poland. And I remember my mom saying, "I'm gonna volunteer for work." Because they knew that who doesn't work, they're gonna probably They have no use for them. So she used to say, I'm going to volunteer for work so I can stay with my family. But she didn't know that they were separating the men and women and young people and older people. So when we got off the train, there was like a chaos. There was screaming, crying, yelling. We didn't know what's going on. I was screaming, and people standing on the other side was screaming. And I says to my mom, why are they screaming? She says, I don't know, maybe they don't know what, I don't know what she said, but she said, I don't know why they're screaming. So I hold on to her so tightly. My father and my brother stood behind. So I looked back and I see them standing there. And me and my sister and my mother walk towards where they told us to walk. And a German soldier sat on the, like I'm sitting now. And when we got to him, he says, you go left, you go right. You go left, you go right. He was separating the people. And I was holding on to my mom, and he took me like this and threw me to the other side. And I see my mom walking. She turned around, and she looked. And I said, I want to go with her. He says, no, you get out of here. Get out of here. You go to the other side. So I ran after my sister. And we stayed there till not everybody came down from the trains. And we started to walk towards a building. But before we got to the building, two men started to run behind us. The man was behind us. They started to run. And two machine guns, they put them down just like this camera. And they started shooting them. And the man, once or twice, they got up, and then they fell. And we had to stop and watch. And then they took those two men and put them in front of the gate when we get in. And he says, everybody who tries to escape, that's what's going to happen to you.
Were these men from your transport?
Those men were already once in Auschwitz. They were Polish, two Polish guys, but they escaped. And now they were going back. They were taking them back. So they knew what's waiting for them. So they started to run, but they knew they had no chance to survive. Anyways, we went into those big, cold place. There was all cement, and they were like showers. And they told us, everybody undress. We undressed, and they shaved us. They shaved our hair, underpits, everywhere they shaved. This is in the shower. But we didn't know that it was shower or what, because we heard already before. So, but, you know, we went, because if you didn't go, they would hit you till you... Some people was resisting, and they died right there before they went in.
Did you know where you were at that time, what the name of the place was?
No. No, I didn't know that, where we were. And they said that before the German, that we find out that the guy was Mengele, who was dividing people. They took little kids from their mother's arms and they give them to other people, to strangers. And the mother sent this way, and the babies with the other strangers, or if there was the grandmother, they give it to the grandmother. And they took them to the other side, but we didn't know why. We thought that we are young and strong, so they're going to take us to work, and the others are going to watch the kids. So when we took a shower, they gave us striped uniform, and they took us in a big... barracks, that they were like three layers, like bang beds. So they had this much, there was this much room, they put seven people So if I had to turn around, everybody had to turn around. We had one blanket, and everybody looked to me the same because they were all shaved. Everybody looked the same, somehow in the same uniform, same hair, like no hair. So you couldn't say who was who, somehow, you know.
Were you able to recognize your sister afterwards?
Yeah, my sister I recognized because we were always together. I wouldn't let go of her. But you didn't want to let the Germans know that you were sisters. Once they know that you were sisters, they separated you. So nobody, you know, I mean, talked that she's my sister, I want to go with her. If they send people out someplace, you couldn't say that because they would separate them right on the spot.
When did you realize where you were?
Well, when we got there, we got a Blockälteste right away. Her name was Alice. She had red hair. And she told us, she says, you see those the flames outside? That's where your parents are. That's where your baby sisters are. That's where your kids are. They're burning. Because the Germans came over and said, if you're good, if you tell us if you're pregnant or something, then you can see your parents. And the girl, the Blockälteste, which meant she was the head of that place, barrack. She told us every day, reminded us, your parents are burning. That's where you are. That's where you're gonna go. See the people, she says, who have tattoos. Those are the people who are going to survive. But you have no tattoos, you're not working, you're going to end up in the crematorium. It's only time that you're going to survive till they finish transporting everybody. So every day there was a new transport, but we had to go into the barracks. It was called Blocksperre, means that you cannot go out because new transports were coming. So they didn't want nobody to see when they were coming, because sometimes you can see that it's your sister or your brother or your, you know, and your. So we were there every night at 2 o'clock. They woke us up to go outside and stay. It was called Zählappel, stay in five in a row. 1,000 people were in one block, one house. And we stayed five in a row till 10 o'clock in the morning, till the German lady or a man with a dog came and counted us. Now, let's say that somebody was sick and they couldn't get out of the thing. So they looked, or somebody ran away. People ran away. People seen, let's say that my sister-in-law or my cousin is in another block. She wanted to stay with her, so they ran away. Until they didn't find the person to make up 1,000, we used to stay sometimes till 4 o'clock in the afternoon with no food, could rain, it wasn't snowing then because it was summer, but rain. We had to stay there and stayed straight because they looked at each one. They were going from one side like this, and looked at each one of us, if we're okay. If they see that somebody's pale or goes like this, right away they took him to the side, and we never see them again. Or somebody, they asked somebody something and they answered, so they started to beat him or beat her, till we was watching it. You know, they had to, you had to watch it, because if you turn away, they started to hit you. Or they let the dog on you. So we were like treated like really like animals. And after half a year, we felt like animals.
Now, when did you find out where it was that you were?
Well, they told us right when we got into the barracks. They said, she said, I'm here already 4 years, and you're in a place that it's Auschwitz-Birkenau, where they have the crematoriums.
Your brothers had sent you that postcard from Birkenau. Mm-hmm. Did you ever see them there?
No, when we got there, we talked to some people because we knew that they were in Birkenau, because the card says Birkenau, the stamp. So we asked some people if they knew this and this person, and a lady says, yes, we knew, because the Czechoslovakian people, they were together, men and women and kids. They were in one lager. It's only, there was a wire that separated us from them, because some were still there when we got there. And they said, yes, your brothers were here. They were working in the kitchen. And just before you came, they took them to the crematoriums. So they were, the day that we got there, they were burned. We were gassed. So we never, after that, we never, but I didn't believe it. I didn't believe it. I said, no, it's impossible, because they were, those two boys were like fire. They sent home their clothes. They sent home before they wanted to come. That's the beginning. Everything, because they knew so many people. They had connections. I said, it's impossible that those two are dead. So, but she says, well, everybody who was in this place, they were taken away one night, and that's what they said, that they were killed.
When people escaped from Salapel,
yeah,
and were they brought back?
Oh yeah, but they were brought back to show us how they killed them right there.
So they were punished right
there? They were punished. Women kicked them in the face, in the head, in the, till they're, well, it didn't take much already. After 6 months, you were like a skeleton, because the only food you got was in the morning a black coffee and a square like this black bread. That was for a whole day. At night, you got an empty soup, which was, I guess, was made from grass, because it was full of sand. That's the food you got. So by then we were like skeletons. So if she hit you once, you're dead. Didn't take much. But they were really, the women, the German women, was really something else. They were hitting and kicking and let the dog on people who didn't know. You didn't know what to do. If you answered them, was no good. If you didn't answer them, wasn't good. So you couldn't win with them. They ask you something and you answer, she says, you're not supposed to talk to me. And if you didn't answer, why aren't you talking to me? So you couldn't win.
Were you only with Hungarian women?
I guess, yeah. Well, they were like prior Hungarian, Czechoslovakian. Before, yeah.
Did you see any other nationalities there?
Yes. Next to us was gypsies and Polish prisoners, but they were treated, they were in family all together. The gypsies were wearing their own clothes. They had hair, their own hair, weren't shaved, and so were the Polish prisoners. So when we got there the first time, we were so thirsty because there was no water, that we sold our bread for water. They gave us in a bottle, I don't know what kind of a water it was, but we exchanged bread for water. So, you couldn't talk too much because they were German soldiers all over, walking, so you couldn't go and talk to them. If he turned around, let's say, so maybe we can talk a word or two, but you couldn't talk to nobody.
How long did you stay at Birkenau?
In Birkenau, I was till August. I think August? Yeah, August. One night, they came, everybody rose, and we thought for sure, now this is the end, because during the night, so everybody was running all over the place. Nobody wanted to stay in the place. Like, we had to stay in five in a row. That was their thing, that everybody had to stay five in a row. So nobody wanted. Me and my sister, we said, let's stay. it couldn't be worse than this. But most of them started running, and it was nighttime, and the Germans were running after them. But they couldn't run too far because, you know, it was all electric wire fence. So by 6 o'clock in the morning, finally, they got the 1,000 people together, and they put us on trucks, and they took us to a place and gave us food. It was out of Auschwitz, another place, but I don't remember the name, and they gave us warm clothing. I said, what's this? This is something, you know, we weren't prepared for treatment like this. And they put us on wagons, and we went to Kaufering. When we went to Kaufering, it was a whole different story, like day and night. There was no crematoriums, there was no SS men, there was no dogs, they were just plain soldiers. So we stood outside because they wanted to count us, and started to rain, and the guy says, why are you staying here? Go in, it's raining. We weren't used to things like that because we weren't treated like that. But that didn't last long. In about 2 weeks, the SS took over. And when the SS took over, everything changed. They started hearing us. They started taking us, we built our own barracks. We stayed in a big wooden place before because there was no barracks. So we dig the holes for the barracks, and we made from, it's like you see the old country, those shacks, you know, that are built from mud, like mud shacks. So that's where we built. And then when we finished building that, they took us, it was already winter, and we had wooden shoes. And you know, when you walk in wooden shoes, the snow piles up on your shoes and you can't walk. Well, you fall, and it's not enough that you fall, but the SS is behind you, hitting you, kicking you, get up. And then took us to wooden areas where we peeled trees. They were cut down logs, and we peeled those. I don't know for what reason.
You took the bark off them?
Yeah, that's what we did. And that was till about, we were there till about January. In January, I guess, or the Russians, or the English were coming close to Bergen-Belsen. So they started to evacuate us, and we started to walk. We walked day and night. We slept in shacks like they had, farmers, they had those empty, just a roof and nothing on the side, you know. So we slept there, and we ate. They had machines that they made wheat. So we scraped that out, took the dust out, and that's what we ate for 6 weeks, because they didn't give you food. And if you sat down, the best friend of mine, was walking with us, lived right till January. She sat down, and they shot her right there. Whoever sit down for a second, they were shooting them. A girl next to me, we were staying in the shack and sleeping, and she was scratching herself because we had all lice. We were covered in lice. She scratched herself to death. You should see that body. And, you know, it didn't affect us. It was like we weren't humans. She was lying beside me and didn't bother me that she was dead, and her flesh, she had no flesh on because she scratched herself so badly that she wasn't like a human anymore. And it somehow didn't affect us, like our minds were maybe it's hunger that does to your body and your mind, that you don't care. I didn't care if I died. And then after 6 weeks or 8 weeks, we went back to Bergen-Belsen.
You went from Kaffering?
No, we went from Kaffering to Bergen-Belsen. We stayed there for about 2 weeks, and they were already closing in the English. So they took us away from there, walked all around, I don't know where we went, and went back to Bergen-Belsen. When we got there, we see piles and piles of bodies, men, women, but not like one, two, but like this house. All, you know, that's all you see is like sticks. The Germans were there, they didn't have no kitchen anymore there, so they didn't give us any food there anymore. We ate rotten, whatever was potatoes or whatever we find, you know, who could eat. Me, I was very sick already. I couldn't eat. So my sister, there was one place where there was a little water dripping from a stone or somewhere. So she made fire and she boiled the water and she gave me to drink the water because I was out of it already. I was just lying there and I was, you know, people were lying all around me dead. And the Germans still came and still kicked you and hit you and get up. How can you get up? I said, you know, I can't even talk. So the last few days, we heard that the Germans are gone. So whoever could walk, they ran right away to the kitchen, but there was no food there. So we were lying there, almost everybody, very, very few people who can stand on their feet. I only remember, well, I'm getting to the end already, is it okay? I only remember I was lying there and somebody came over and put a white cross on my forehead. And my sister was running after the soldiers, please take my sister because she's dying, please take her to the hospital. So they were almost, everybody was dying. So and one bad thing they did give everybody, when the English came in, they gave everybody food. And whoever could, they ate and they got sick and lots of them died. Because it's too rich, the food was too rich for them. So finally they took me to, they made a hospital there in Bergen-Belsen. And they separated me from my sister because my sister wasn't as sick as me. They put me in an ambulance. They sprayed me with something and they gave me clean clothes. And they put me on a bed, and I only remember I got up from the bed. I was so thirsty that people were there. They were spitting in.
We're going to stop here and go to the next tape. Can you please continue telling us about Bergen-Belsen Hospital?
Yes, they took me to a hospital, and I was very thirsty. I guess I had high fever, and there was nobody around there that I can ask for water. So some people were very sick that they had TB and all kinds of things, and they had things that, it's gross. This was spilling in it, and I tried to drink that, and somebody just slapped, somebody came there and took it away from me because, you know, the people who were there, they were half dead. I was like, I got off the bed, but You seen Muslim man, it's called. It was like I had two sticks. I weighed 60 pounds, not more. But I was so thirsty that I got out of bed and I said, I have to have a drink. And then I was not supposed to drink. So I was there for about 6 weeks, but in the meantime, I was asking for my sister. said, my sister was supposed to be here. Where is she? So they said, well, what's your sister's name? I said, Rally Blyer. So they said, okay, we're going to look for her. And one day a Hungarian soldier came. I don't know what he was doing there. I guess after the war, they were looking after us, the Hungarian soldiers, because they were... they used to stay in those places where they made the hospitals. And he says, is Blyer Iboja here, in Hungarian? I says, yeah. He says, your sister is looking for you. She's in the other building. So that's how we got together. She was better, and I got better in 6 weeks. And we stayed there in Bergen-Belsen for about 4 weeks till we got a little bit stronger. And then we said, we want to go home and find out if anybody is home from the family. So they put us on wagons, no roof, no sides. They had no trains. Trains must have been destroyed or something. So it took about 3 or 4 days till we got from Germany to Czechoslovakia. And in, I think we went to Košice, and they were the UNRWA people were there. They took they asked all kind of questions, their names, and we asked if they heard anything about our parents, or they said no, they didn't hear nothing. But if we stay there for a while, maybe they'll find out through the Red Cross. We stayed there for about a week. I think they put us up in hotels. And then we didn't hear nothing. So it was like a whole, not only us, there were people who came with us, a lot of young people. So we all went to Budapest. When we stayed in Budapest, in a place, the same thing, in a school, and we tried to send, people were going to Shatorjói Hall. We send words that we're here if anybody is from our family there. So we got a message that one of Blyer's brother is in Czechov, and one sister. So we were so happy. I said to my sister, you see, their brothers didn't die, but it was my cousin. It was my cousin and my sister Olga, who's gonna come here. She was home. So she came for us, we went home. And I stayed there about a week. I went and looked at my house when I lived, and I knocked on the door, and some people lived there, and there were strangers living there, taking over everything, and I felt like somebody took my heart out, you know. I was expecting my parents in there. I was expecting somebody there from our. So I went back because there was about 6 or 7 people who came back from our town. The rest didn't come, so they all lived in one house. They took over one house and they lived there. My cousin, who was already much older than me, my sister, and some other people who came back, and I said, no, I can't stay here. I have to go someplace, but I didn't know where to go. And one of the girl's brother was working for Shomer Hatzair, and he says, listen, there's lots of young people. If you want to come, you come there, and from there you can go to Palestine. So I said, anywhere, I have to get out of here. So I went with him there, and I stayed there with a lot of young people, and they sent us out for work. I learned some embroidery, and then I got I forgot to mention that my sister, older sister, in 1936 came out to the States, because my mother's and my father's family, they were all in the States. The only person who stayed, my mother was the youngest, so she stayed with her parents. And my father was the youngest, so he stayed with his parents. So they didn't go to America. So they sent out, they wanted to send more out, but they shut the borders for Jewish people. So my sister came out and I got a telegram and my aunt not to go to Israel because from Israel it's going to be hard to go and they want us to go to the States. So I had to leave Shomer HaTzair because they only send people to Israel. But there was there Aguda. You know what Aguda is? Only girls, very religious. And I went there and they took me in. They were very happy that they saved the Jewish girl because the Shomer was not religious. And the other ones was very religious. You know, the
Aguda. Was this in Kozice too?
Pardon me?
Was this in Kozice too?
Yeah, in Košice, yeah. So I stayed there and they always called me a little Shomer because you had to wear long sleeve, but they permitted me not to wear long sleeves and stockings because they were very religious. So one day a rabbi, Rabbi Schoenberg, his name, came from England to that place. And he says 150 young people, if they want to come to England, they're going to arrange for passports and everything. So I decided, I said, I'm going to go. But in meantime, my sister was still home and I begged her, really, please come and we'll go together. So she decided and she came there and we came to England. He made the passports and arranged everything for us. We just went for a physical because whoever had TB or anything like that, they couldn't emigrate. So we went, came to London and we stayed there in a house, only girls. And we got bad news there. They said, you have to wait for a quota to go to United States because there was a lot of people wanted to emigrate to the States. So they said, but there is another option if you want to go to Canada. I never heard of Canada, you know. I mean, I did hear because some farmers from our town came here long time and I heard something Canada. I thought it was a farm land, you know, just farm. So I said, yeah, I want to go. So I said, Canada must be close to the States. So if I'm here already, I can go see my sister and my aunt. So we came on a boat. That was my best time of my life since I left home on the boat. Was like going on a holiday.
When was that? What year?
August 1948. We were on a boat a whole week. Aquitania, the boat's name is Aquitania, and we got to Halifax. And in Halifax, we had to stay 2 days because we had to come by train, and they arranged sleeping accommodation for us. But a family in Halifax took me in, and they wanted to adopt me. A Russian family, just a husband and a wife. They had a beautiful home. They took me shopping. They got me clothes because I had no clothes. My feet were swollen, so they went to about 7 or 8 stores to buy me shoes, till they find me shoes. They were wonderful people. But I said no because my sister wasn't coming with me then. She was in Ireland. Because she was older, so the older people they took to Ireland and the younger they took to England, to London. So I said, no, my sister's going to come and she's going to join me. So that's the only family that I have. So they felt bad. They said, you're going to have a good home here. You're young. You can make, you know, you're... I said, no, I'm going to go to Canada.
Do you remember the couple's name?
No. I know they're from Russia, Russian. And remember the first day they gave me, first morning they gave me half a grapefruit. I didn't know what it was. So when she turned around, I put it in the garbage because it was bitter. I wasn't used to eating grapefruit. So, but they were such a nice people. And then I came to Montreal, and right away the Jewish Congress took over. So they put us with families, like a room. They give us room and board. And for about a year, they just, you know, they gave us $3 pocket money for a month. $60 they paid for room and board for a month. But the people were nice. They were like, you know, when you came here after the war, everybody felt sorry for you. Because we were young people. Okay, I wasn't that young. I was already in my 20, 21. But still, you know, they knew after what we went through. So they were like parents. They wanted to be like parents to us. They took us in with such a love, you know. It wasn't like I was a boarder.
But did they ask you about your experiences?
They asked us, yeah, but I wasn't talking much. I don't know, I couldn't do myself talking. So I just said, you know, yeah, you know, they asked me my parents, I lost my parents, I lost my brothers, but I wasn't talking, but they knew what we went through because it was all over the newspapers by then. I mean, even if they, the first time they didn't want to believe it, because we didn't want to believe it. My father didn't want to believe it. My father said it's a hoax. It's not true. They wouldn't do that. I was born here. My father was born here. They couldn't do that. They did it. I mean, after about, that was 48, 49, 50, I wanted a home already. I thought I was in love, so I married him. It was in 51. And I was working in a factory. He wasn't working. And we just grew apart. So I came here. I came to Toronto. A friend of mine lived here, so she asked me, come here and live here. So I lived with her for a while. I met my husband.
When did you come to Toronto?
I came in 56, 50, 57. I came to Toronto in 57. I met my husband a week after. I went back to Montreal. I packed up and I came here.
What is your present husband's name?
John. John Cole. And he came from South America. He was... He had a brother here, so he was a newcomer here too when I met him. He didn't speak any English.
Is he a survivor as well?
Yes.
Where was he born?
He was born in Hungary, Damecer. Yeah, but he was hiding in Budapest, and in September I think they took him to Auschwitz, to Bergen-Belsen. So we got liberated at the same place, but we didn't know each other.
When you started your new life in Toronto?
Well, I found a job. I was working in a bakery selling. And the couple I worked for was an old elderly lady, very, very nice, Mrs. God, I forgot her name. She was really like a mother to me. I used to go to sleep with her when her husband went to the hospital. She said, you come and stay with me. She had a big house on, the part over Eglinton?
Forest Hills?
Forest Hills, yeah. Spencer, Mrs. Spencer, yeah. And... In meantime, I was in process of my divorce, but the lawyer wanted $1,000. I was making $30 a week. I had no money. So she gave me the money, and I paid her $5 a week back. So I can, because he wouldn't give me the divorce till I didn't pay him. So she gave me the money to pay. Such a wonderful woman. And then in 59 I got married again. I got my divorce in 58, 59. And my first child was born in 1961.
And which child is that?
Debbie. And 1962, Ran was born. And my husband worked three jobs to support us. At that time, there was... Then after 15 years, the kids were 15 years old, I went back to work too.
What did you do?
I worked in retail, selling clothes. And my daughter went to university, and she got sick.
And did your son get married?
Yes, my son got married. He's going to be married 1988. He got married in 1988.
Yes. Who did he marry?
He married an Italian girl.
What's her name?
Nella. They were sweethearts from school. They were going out till since six. She was 16 or 15. And about 10 years they were going out together.
And do they have any children?
They have one little boy, David. My pride and joy. And David is going to be 18 months, September the 6th. 18 months, a year and a half.
Is he named after your father?
Yes. Yes.
Just to go back a little bit, you were brought up very Orthodox.
Yes.
During the war, when you were in the camps, did you observe?
Yes. Yom Kippur, we didn't have much to eat, but we didn't. We put away our piece of bread, and we was in covering. So we were outside freezing. My hands were frostbitten, so for years and years were itchy and on my feet. And we were outside praying and not eating and praying to God that, you know, because you still hope on the end already, towards the end, I didn't care, but that was a few months. Well, Yom Kippur was, you know, in the fall. We were already in Kaufering, which is a little bit more humane. We didn't see no burning and smelling flesh, you know, and books, because people even brought prayer books with them, and they were all burning. And you can see that. There we only were 1,000 people. Not like there was about 20,000 in that one place where we were. So now I don't fast. Since I came back, I'm not religious. Somehow my parents, before they took them, they went to the synagogue because they already felt that we were gonna be going, not before, but just after we went to the ghetto. They went and said the death prayer, because they were religious, you know. They wouldn't even take a handkerchief on a Saturday. They wouldn't carry. And we were brought up like that. We had kosher in the house. But since then, I said, if God forbid, kids, small kids, innocent kids, let them die this way, I don't think I can. I don't believe. Because those people really, you know, that time they were religious. They prayed and prayed, so what did it get them? They gassed them, and maybe they were half dead when they burned them.
Did you talk to your children about your experiences?
Yeah, my son knows. My daughter doesn't know much. She can't take too much of, very depressed. So I don't know if it goes with that, but she doesn't, she says, Mom, don't tell me. But my son knows, yes. He was the one who was telling me to do it, because people are dying out.
Is this the reason why you've come forward today?
Yes.
Do you have a message that you want to tell your son, your grandson, perhaps even great-grandchildren when they watch this? Something that we can learn from your experiences?
Well, I just hope that this will never, never happen again. It shouldn't have happened the first time. What else can I say? I mean, it's an ordeal that no human being should go through.
When you read the papers today and you see what's happening in Bosnia and Rwanda...
I feel with them. I feel with them because I know what they go through. And people should help. People should go and do something about it. Not just wait, sit back and wait till it's too late. They should try to help, because they didn't help us, that's for sure.
You described yourself as a young girl as being the kind of person who would hold on to mother's apron. When you look back now, do you recognize her as yourself?
Well, they say that I look like her a lot. And, well, I guess history repeats itself, because my daughter is the same as me. Like I was.
But do you recognize yourself as a young child? Do you think the same way you used to? Do you act the same way you used to? Or did the war change you?
Well, I think maybe not. You see, she had, before the war, she had a very good life. Because my father was making good money, and she had all the help that she needed, because she had 8 kids. Don't forget, they didn't have baby food and they didn't have washing machines. So, you know, so she had help. I grew up after the war. I didn't grow up before the war. I was, before the war, even if I was 17, I thought I was a little girl. Like, I had to have my mother. If I didn't have my mother, I couldn't live without her. Today, the girls are not like that. And she was a very strong woman. She was really, I don't know if I could stand, maybe I could, if it comes to my children, stand up the way she stood up to the German and said, "Don't you ever dare touch my child." Maybe if the time would come, maybe I would do the same thing. But she had a lot of courage, because they could have shot her right there. They didn't think twice.
What were your dreams when you were a child? What did you want to be when you grew up?
I don't know. I guess to grow up and get, my mother always said, "You're going to get a nice boy and you're going to get," because I was the only one who was with her to the last. And she always says, "You're going to get married and you're going to have a nice husband." I mean, you know, I was 17, but like I said, I don't think my mind was a 17. I wasn't, I don't know how I felt like I was 10 or 11. I don't know why, because so the closeness that I had with my mother, and that everybody from my family left and I was with her, I was always afraid I might lose her. She's going to die. Because she was 50 years old. That time, the women, 50, they looked older. So she had no hair, you know, because she used to wear a kerchief. So the people looked older. And I was always that, she was old, she's going to die. I'm so afraid. Nights, I didn't sleep. Sometimes I went into her bed near her feet and stayed with her, slept. With her there, because I'm afraid that she's... I had those feelings, I don't know why, that she's going to die, leave me. So maybe it's just that feeling that, like, somebody feels something, that it's going to come true, I don't know. But I always had that feeling, and I never told anybody. But I was always afraid. In the morning, I looked if she's alive.
When you were separated from her, how did you manage then during the wartime in the camps?
I was a basket case. I didn't want to eat. I didn't want to get up from the. My sister said, "If you're not, they're gonna shoot you." I said, "I don't care. I want to go with my mother. I don't care what they do. I don't want to eat. If she's not there, I'm not here for sure, because I didn't have enough in me to go. You know, to leave. Like some people are sick and they give up. I gave up. I didn't want to leave, because I said, if I don't have my mother, I don't want to leave." She says, "You're nuts. Come on. Don't want to stay alone. Come." And she used to pinch my cheeks when we stayed in the five and hold her hand behind me so I don't go back, because I was very weak. I didn't want to eat.
Was this Rally?
Rally, yeah. She was strong. I was always huskier and stronger, like in physically, but mentally she was much stronger. She was much stronger. And if it's not her, I don't think I go through. No.
Who from your family came back from the war, the brothers and the sisters?
Just my sister Ali and my sister Olga. That's all.
And Charlotte was in the States.
And Charlotte was in the States.
What happened to the oldest two brothers. What happened?
The younger, Robert, he was working in a working commando. And just before the war, he went to our town, and the people asked him, backed him, because they already knew. They changed their standing too, you know, when they see that the Germans are losing. So they backed him. "Please stay. Your parents are going to come back, and you're going to be here." He says, "No, I'm going and I'm going to find my parents and my family." But that was the last thing. That's what they told us when we got home, my neighbors. My little brother, he died with my father. He was 9 years old, so he was gassed with my father the same day when we arrived.
So you don't know where Robert died?
No, I have no idea. No.
Do you know what he died of?
They said that he had pneumonia. He was sick. He was very sick when they begged him to stay, and he wouldn't stay. He says, "No, I have to find my family."
We're going to stop here and go to the next tape. Did you ever go back to Czechoslovakia or Hungary?
No, to Hungary I went once. To Czechoslovakia, never. I only went to Hungary because my husband has two sisters there. And the kids were 10 and 11. We went to visit them. My husband goes back every year since then, but I never went back.
Do you ever dream about your experiences?
I always dream. I always dream that I see my mother going. The way she left when I last seen her, and there is a big, big hole in front of her. But I can't see if she's going in there or it's like a fog. And that dream comes reappearing all the time.
Is it exactly the way you remember seeing her?
I see her going, she just turned back once, and she's seen me probably crying, and then she walked slowly to the left, and after that, it was such a chaos there, but everybody was screaming. The guys that cleared the wagons, they were screaming, "Stand here, stand there, go there, go here." They were like, we didn't know what hit us. You know, when you get out of that wagon, half dead, and then all of a sudden those people come at you with rubber hoses and tell you, "You go here, you go there, you go there." You're stunned. It's like a dream. You don't expect things like that. You know, it's like, what is this? This is not people, those are animals. They treat you like you're a leopard. It's awful. It's awful feeling. So the only thing, I looked back once when my father and my little brother was, and I went with my mother. I hold on to her, and the way he separated me, he goes like this, He cut me off, and I still ran after her, and then he pushed me to the other side.
Did she say anything to you before?
I don't remember. I don't remember. She said, I remember her looking back, and I remember the coat she was wearing, a gray coat. She says, I'm going to put the coat on so I have it if it's cold, because it wasn't cold. She says, I'm going to have it. We wore three or four kind of clothes on us because we couldn't take not just one suitcase. And we thought if they take away the suitcase, we have the clothes on us to change. But we had to take the clothes off.
And when you were on the train, mm-hmm. did your father say anything to you or to your brother?
My brother, oh, the little brother? Well, I don't remember. I really don't remember. I just remember that there were people who were dead and smelled, and I was asking, when are we going to be there? When are we going to be? And we had a little food, I think, and a little water. And my father and my mother says, soon, soon, don't worry, soon. We're going to be there soon. But, you know, because you're in a place like that, squished, you can't sit down. You can imagine 100 people in a place that you're stuck together, you breathe on you, the stank, and we had to go to the pail. You had to go between. It was awful. And then I thought, oh, we're going to get there. We're going to get water. We're going to get food. We got hit from those guys and pushed and yelled. And so we had no, like, I said, when is it going to end? What are they going to do to us? That's all we wanted, water, you know. But you didn't get water. You got beaten and you got screamed and yelled. And it was awful.
Do you think any of the choices you've made in the last 50 years have been affected by your experiences, that you've made choices based on your experiences during the war?
Like what?
That you've chosen to do certain things or not do certain
yes,
things because
yes,
of your experiences?
Yes. I like some people want to have big houses, lots of fancy furniture, lots of material things. No. I'm here 30 years already in this house. And I just don't have the. When I'm going to move in a condominium probably. When we won't be able to take care of the garden. But I had never. Material things doesn't matter to me. Never. And saving. I'm only saving because of my daughter. Because maybe she won't be able to look after herself. But for me, I don't crave for big things. I don't want big cars. I don't want big houses. Everybody, when we moved here, it was a Jewish district. There was maybe two Jewish people left here. Because, everybody moved further out. I says, no, this is good for me. I don't want to move. Look what happened. You had everything and you had to leave everything. Material things are nothing. What's if you have money and you have a big house, and does it make you happy? No. What makes you happy is your kids, your grandchildren. That's where you get your strength from.
Before we close and go to the photographs and your family, is there anything else you'd like to add?
Well, I just hope that I'll live till my son has a bar mitzvah.
Till my grandson
has a bar mitzvah to see him. Yeah. Well, I don't think so. I think that should be taken off. Can you take that off? No. You know why? Because. Well, I'm not going to say it on the film.
On that note, I'd like to thank you very much for coming forward today and telling us your testimony.
You're welcome. This is my brother, older brother. That's the only picture I have from my family. And I got this from my sister who is in the States. His name is Jack Blyer. We called him Janu. That's in Hungarian.
Approximately how old is he in this photograph?
He's around in his early 30s. This is my three sisters and myself. Left to right is my oldest sister, her name is Charlotte Jacobs, married name. The second oldest is Olga Varady. The third one is Rally Newman, and myself. And this picture was taken in Montreal in the middle of the 50s. My sister came down from New York. She used to live in New York, and we all took this picture. This is my husband and my daughter, Debbie. She's about a year old, so it must have been in 1962, and he could be around 34 years old then. That was taken in Toronto. This is Debbie. She's 2 years old. Ron is, it must be, this is 1962. Ron is about 6 months old. He was born in March, so this is in the fall. And myself, this is the previous house we used to live in. Hi, I want to introduce my family. From right to left, my favorite daughter-in-law, Nella Kohn, my sister, Olga Varady, my daughter, Debbie Kohn, my husband, Jan Kohn, my son, Ron Kohn, and my favorite little boy, David Kohn. And now I think my son wants to say something.
Well, all I really want to say is,
look at.
I was an advocate, I guess, of after hearing what you were doing with putting a documentary or a history file together for remembrance of the Holocaust. Ever since I was young enough to remember, I knew a little bit about the Holocaust, and as I got older, I learned more and more about it. But I never had, I could never understand the true horror.
Okay, baby. Mommy has you.
I guess the true horror that my family and other families went through during that time frame. And talking with friends and finding out that there wasn't that much of awareness out there, unless a lot of people were directly involved, had parents or cousins or aunts involved. I thought this would be a great way to make sure that everybody had an understanding of how bad it was and what happened, and that it would never happen again. And after I had my son David, I felt it was really important for him to have that. So when he gets older, he'll understand exactly what his family, his parents, his grandparents and their parents went through. So it wouldn't just be a hearsay or a story or something you look in a history book, but there'll be a face to the name, a face to the people that went through the horror. And that's why I think it was really important that my mother put her story on record, and everybody else, I guess, who is putting their story on record. So people like my son David would have something to look at when they get of age and understand exactly what went on.